Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the Mike Rose essay. I'll do at least two videos on this essay, just to give you a sense of what to look for. Hopefully by now you've also had a time to go into Blackboard and to see the notes that I posted. And as I mentioned in the announcement that I put up yesterday, I do that for most of the readings we'll do over the course of the semester. So you'll get a set of notes that go through major terms in the essay, major ideas. Also, you know, I'll point out some of the ideas that I think are most significant, which is the case with some of the notes that I put up. So they're designed, as I've already mentioned, to help you not only read the essay and to, you know, dig a little deeply into it, but also to think a bit about the paper that you're going to develop based on the essays that we're reading. Now, in this particular case, we're using Mike Rose more as a model. So we're not going to be directly responding to him. That's going to be a little bit different with some of the later essays that we do. But for this one, you're using him as a model for your own essay that's due in a couple of weeks, because you will be writing about a work or volunteer experience that you've had. As I've mentioned, you could also write about someone else's experience. If you've had a chance to look at that first writing assignment, you'll see the options that are available. But no matter what you write about, this essay is going to be the sort of model or the focus of it. And so today what I want to talk about a little bit is the structure. The structure of this essay is maybe a little bit unusual in comparison to other pieces that you've read, maybe for other classes. It's probably very different from the essays that you yourself have written, because one thing you're going to notice about it is that he flips what the normal structure of most essays would be. Normally, and this is the way we're all taught, I was taught this way, I'm sure you were as well, we're taught to always open with a great thesis statement. That's still valid. You know, most of the essays that we're going to write will open in that very same way, with a strong thesis, a main idea that gives the reader a suggestion of what's going to happen in the rest of the essay. This one doesn't quite do that. And if you've already had a chance to read it, you've noticed that. If you haven't had a chance to read it yet, you're going to probably notice that what he does is he starts with a narrative. He starts with a few narratives, actually. He talks about his mother and her work that she did in the 1950s. He talks about his uncle. He talks a little bit about his own background as a student and as a professor. And then he ends it with the main idea, with the main argument. So he uses all those examples in the first half of the essay, first two-thirds of the essay, I guess we could say, to build up to the point that he's trying to make. So the main concept of this essay, the thesis, the main idea, whatever you want to call it, actually appears in the last few paragraphs. Okay, so when you're reading it, or if you want to reread it and think about it again, if you've already taken a look, pay really close attention to those last few paragraphs. In fact, I'm going to read a couple of passages from them for you here in a second, because the narrative is really interesting. You know, we learn a lot about his mom. As I mentioned last week, he's drawing on memory. And if you watched my other video, you'll know that I'm a big proponent of using memory as the foundation for any good piece of writing. You're drawing on your experience, you're drawing on your ideas, your feelings, your emotions, to express something to somebody else. And he does that, right? He starts off talking about his mother, about the experiences she had as a waitress in that diner when he was a child. If you've gone on Blackboard and you've seen the other notes that I've posted, I've even included a photograph of her that's normally included in the print versions of this essay, so that you can kind of get a sense of the setting and also of her and of what she looks like. You know, then again, he moves on to his uncle and his experiences at the car company. But then he ends it in something that looks more like a persuasive essay. So the most of it's narrative. It's the stories about his experience of work, especially his experience of work as seen through the eyes of his mother and his uncle. But then he shifts a little bit at the end of it. And you notice that he's shifting, because there's a point at which in the middle he starts talking about René Descartes, the philosopher. I'm not going to talk as much about him today. I'll save that for another video later this week. But at the very end of the essay, after he pivots into this sort of argumentative style, he makes a couple of statements that I think are really important and I want you to think about and reflect on. And I want to read those to you. So what I'm about to read to you, excuse me, would be the last two paragraphs of the essay. So if you have it in front of you now, if you want to scroll to it and take a look, I'm at the very end of it, and I want to read the last two paragraphs, and I want to discuss those, and I want you to think about them a little bit, particularly as you're looking ahead a couple of weeks and you're thinking about your first essay for the class. So here's what he says. If we believe everyday work to be mindless, then that will affect the work we create in the future. When we devalue the full range of everyday cognition, and cognition, remember, is thinking, the different styles of thinking, we offer limited educational opportunities and fail to make fresh and meaningful instructional connections among the disparate kinds of skill and knowledge. If we think that whole categories of people identified by class or occupation are not that bright, then we reinforce social separations and cripple our ability to talk across cultural divides. That's the second to last paragraph. It's critical. So you really want to pay careful attention to that. And it's often ignored. I've even seen commentaries on this essay where the focus is so much on the narrative that people forget about the argument that he's making. And he makes one more point. So that's the second to last paragraph. And then he says this: affirmation of diverse intelligence is not a retreat to a soft-hearted definition of the mind. So what is he making an argument for here? He's making an argument for, as he says, these diverse intelligences, different skill sets. Everybody, according to him, has a different skill, a different talent, a different ability, a different vocation, if you want to use that word. But unfortunately, from his perspective, he thinks that sometimes in our society, we don't respect all those differences, or those differences, I should say. So for example, in his case, he's a college professor. His mother worked as a server in this diner, probably in other restaurants, when he was a kid, and yet he still admires her. He's trying to make an argument for the kind of skills that she needed to develop to be successful in that environment. And what he says also is that, unfortunately, in our society, in our culture, we devalue or undervalue, as he suggests, different kinds of work. So we consider certain kinds of work to be valuable and other kinds of work not to be as valuable and or not as essential in some ways. And he thinks this is a problem. He's seeing everybody as having a different role in society, and he's arguing for the idea that everybody should be equally respected, that all these different jobs and positions that people have, no matter what they are, whether they're white collar, whether they're blue collar, that they all play a role in the way our society works. It's an argument, you'll notice, and I'm about to read the final sentence, that's a lot about American democracy, and that's really where this essay ends up. So let me read the last couple of sentences to you. He says, to acknowledge a broader range of intellectual capacity is to take seriously the concept of cognitive variability. And I'll go back to that phrase in a minute. To appreciate in all the Rosies and the Joes, the thought that drives their accomplishments and defines who they are. This is a model of the mind that is worthy of a democratic society. So what's he doing here at the end? Well, clearly, he's honoring the memories of his uncle Joe, and his mother, Rosie. He says also that he's trying to honor the work of people like his uncle Joe and his mother, Rosie, who also work in blue-collar professions. He's trying to analyze those professions. He's trying to analyze the cognitive, the thinking abilities that people employ when they perform these kinds of tasks. He's trying to elevate them. He's trying to show respect, not only for his lineage and his memory of these people in his family, but also trying to make an argument about what works best in a democratic society like the one in which we live. That's a lot to go with, right? That's pretty heavy thinking in what might initially appear to be an essay that is solely focused on these memories of his mother and his memories of her, and again, of his uncle. But the shift that he takes at the end is to that argument. And when he uses a phrase like cognitive variability or the broader range of intellectual capacity, those are key terms in this essay, and he's trying to break them down. Another phrase that he uses is a cognitive biography, where he's trying to write about the different skill sets that are necessary for different kinds of jobs. Now, why is this significant? Well, it makes a lot of important statements about what it means to have a fair and equitable society where we respect all these different levels, no matter what level you're working at. So that's part of his goal here. But for your essay that's coming up in a couple of weeks, I've encouraged you to think about a job or a volunteer experience that you have that might be taken for granted, that maybe you didn't even think about that carefully. Maybe you did the job, you did the best that you could, and you didn't really reflect on it. So what he's asking you to do here, and the model that he's providing, is one in which you have the opportunity to reflect on those memories of that work experience or that volunteer experience. Or again, if you want to interview somebody else and ask about their work experiences, you're welcome to do that as well. But the trick is to ask them or ask yourself questions about the kind of skills that you needed to perform this job effectively. So there's a lot happening in this essay, and I've just only scratched the surface in this preliminary video. The next one that I'm going to post in a couple of days will talk a little bit about how he uses the philosophy of Rene Descartes in the middle and why he thinks that's significant. So for now, just to sum up, what I want you to think about would be two things. First of all, go back and take a look at those last two paragraphs. Again, that is where he places his main idea. He builds up to it. He doesn't start with it and then explain it. And then the second thing I want you to think about is how could you write your own cognitive autobiography, if we want to use that phrase. So in other words, if you've had a job experience like the one I had working at that factory, I mentioned that before, if you've worked at a fast food restaurant, if you've worked at a Jewel, at a Walmart, any of those kinds of places, if you've been a volunteer for a religious organization, for your high school, any of these experiences, again, we do them, but we often don't reflect on them. And so that's what he's asking us to do. And as a writer, that's what he's interested in. So the first paper that we're going to be focusing on for the next couple of weeks is going to ask you to analyze one of these experiences that you've had in the same way that he analyzes the experiences that his mother had, that his uncle had, and he tries to see those skill sets that they needed. He tries to look at what thinking or cognitive abilities that these family members needed to perform these jobs, not only effectively, but really well and really successfully. So that's where we're headed with the first paper. It's why I asked you that last question on the introductory questions for this week about, you know, a job or a volunteer experience that you've had. And as I've been reading those as they've come in, I've really enjoyed reading about some of your experiences. So, as I said, think about that. Why does he put that thesis, that main idea at the end of it? What does that thesis or main idea mean to you? What are your thoughts on it? And start thinking ahead. What can you use from this essay, from his descriptions, from his structure? How can you adopt some of his techniques, if we'll call them that, his strategies for your own essay that's going to be coming up in a couple of weeks? Okay. So again, if you have any questions on any of this material, on this essay, please email me, ask me. I hope you've enjoyed reading it. If you haven't had a chance yet, I hope you enjoy it once you have a chance to sit down and really focus on it. In the next day or so, I'm going to post another video on this essay where I talk a little bit about, again, those passages in the middle where he switches from the narrative to the more persuasive part of the essay, the more argumentative part of the essay. So think about that a little bit too. Take a look at those other notes that I've posted on Blackboard, and I'll see you again to talk more about this essay in the next day or so. Okay, thanks.